12. Going to start the last two words of verse 13 and then roll on into verse 14. Romans 12, beginning at verse 13, the last two words. Paul says, practice hospitality. Bless those who persecute you. Bless and do not curse. Rejoice with those who rejoice. Mourn with those who mourn. Live in harmony with one another. Do not be proud, but be willing to associate with people of low position. Do not be conceited. Do not repay anyone evil for evil. Be careful to do what is right in the eyes of everyone. If it is possible, as far as it depends on you, live at peace with everyone. Do not take revenge, my dear friends, but leave room for God's wrath. For it is written, it is mine to avenge. I will repay, says the Lord. On the contrary, if your enemy is hungry, feed him. If he's thirsty, give him something to drink. In doing this, you will heap burning coals on his head. I'm going to talk about what that means. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. Let's pray and invite the Holy Spirit to speak to us. Father, thank you for the people you love so much. Thank you for your presence with us. Father, I pray that we would encounter you today through the ministry of your word. If your heart agrees, would you say amen and amen? A priest got up to deliver the homily one Sunday morning, and he read Jesus' command, love your enemies. And then he asked, how many people here feel that you have many enemies? Please raise your hand. Not surprisingly, a lot of hands went up across the congregation. The priest then asked, how many of you feel like you have a few enemies? Please raise your hands. About half the number of hands went up. The priest went on, raise your hand if you have only one or two enemies. And a sprinkling of hands went up. Finally, the priest said, now raise your hand if you have no enemies. The priest looked around for a moment, and way in the back, he saw one hand belonging to an elderly gentleman. Delighted, the priest invited the man to come to the front. He said, what a wonderful Christian example you are. How old are you, sir? The man answered, Father, I'm 98 years old and I have no enemies. The priest said, please tell us, what is your secret that you have no enemies? And the elderly man said, all the bums have died. Today I want to share about what I believe is the single most difficult thing in all the Christian life. It's harder than overcoming addictive sin. It's harder than tithing and trusting God with your finances. It's harder than suffering. It's even harder than reconciling the death of a loved one. It's loving our enemies. In Romans 12, Paul quotes the teaching of Jesus more closely than anywhere in all of his letters. In the beautiful Sermon on the Mount, Jesus said, you have heard it said, love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I tell you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you, that you may be children of your Father in heaven. In the parallel passage in Luke 6, Jesus upped the ante even more. He said, love your enemies. Do good to those who hate you. Bless those who curse you. Pray for those who mistreat you. Beloved, when Jesus commanded us to love our enemies, he wasn't merely putting out warm, fuzzy sentiments. He wasn't just hanging lofty ideals out there. I'll set the bar high, and even though they'll never be able to reach it, it'll at least give them something to stretch for. No, when Jesus commands us to love our enemies, to pray for them, to bless them, to do good to them, he actually means it. Jesus is revealing the will of the Father for every child of the kingdom of heaven. You remember Jesus said, not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, only the one who does the will of my Father. And part of the Father's will is loving our enemies. In Romans 12, Paul echoes Jesus' command to love our enemies in the same context. It's part of discovering and doing the Father's will. And if it's God's will for us to love our enemies, that means it is not an impossible task for us in Christ. If God told us to do it, then he must also provide us with everything we need to actually fulfill it. And one of the things that we need is a radical mental metamorphosis. Right now, we're talking about the transformed Christian mind. Our starting place is Romans 12:2. Paul says there, don't be conformed to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. That word transformed, we told you, is the Greek word metamorphosis. It describes the transformation of a tadpole into a bullfrog or a caterpillar into a butterfly. That means that when we become followers of Jesus, the change we need in our thinking is not just a little tweak. We need a radical overhaul. It also means that this transformation is a process. After Paul tells us that we need a transformed mind, he begins to describe the new way Christians think, and remarkably, he starts with the subject of love. In verses 3 through 13 of Romans 12, Paul tells us how we should love our fellow Christians. We talked about that last time we were together. Now in verses 14 to 21, Paul tells us how we should love non-Christians and especially anti-Christians, people who persecute us because of our faith in Christ. Looking at Paul's words, I want to share for a few minutes about why we should love our enemies and how we can do it. Why should we love our enemies and how can we do it? Let's share four whys and three hows. Love your enemies, four whys and three hows. The first why is this. Why should I love my enemies? Because it's imitating my Father in heaven. During his earthly ministry, Jesus taught a spiritual principle. Children resemble their spiritual fathers. To the Pharisees who were conspiring to kill him, Jesus said, you know, you're acting just like your father, the devil. He was a murderer from the beginning. But to his disciples, Jesus said, when you love your enemies, you show that you belong to your Father in heaven. For he is kind to the ungrateful and wicked. He is merciful. Jesus said, blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the sons of God. As followers of Jesus, we have a whole new mission in life. Our mission is to testify of a God that is unlike any other God that is worshiped by men, a God who loves his enemies. You know, men are always looking for proof that God exists. Actually, the proof is everywhere. All of creation, and especially the uniqueness of mankind in creation, is proof that God exists. Human history, especially the history of the Jewish people, the Bible, the church, these are all proofs, and Christians who love their enemies. Earlier in Romans, Paul wrote, God demonstrated his love for us in this, that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. While we were God's enemies, listen, while we were God's enemies, he reconciled us to himself through the death of his son. Jesus said the world only knows about one kind of love, love for our friends and animosity for our foes. But when we love our enemies, we testify that another kind of love has come into the world. A higher love, a purer love, a merciful, forgiving love. When we love our enemies, we testify that we have become recipients of this love and it has changed us. When we love our enemies, not only do we offer the world proof that God exists, but we testify that he is unlike anything or anyone else on earth. Love your enemies, four whys and three hows. Why should I love my enemies? Number one, because it's imitating my Father. Number two, because it's following Jesus in the crucified life. Jesus said, if anyone wants to be my disciple, he must deny himself, take up his cross and follow me. You know, the world these days says express yourself, but Jesus says deny yourself. The world says be true to yourself, but Jesus says deny yourself. The world says go ahead, help yourself, but Jesus says deny yourself. And loving our enemies requires us to die to self and to follow Jesus in the crucified life. Loving our enemy requires us to lay down our pride. It requires us to lay down our dignity at times, our rights at times. When we love our enemies, we show that we're disciples of the one who laid down his life for his enemies. And beloved, listen, that's not just some abstract theological idea. Jesus did this for me. You see, when I love my enemies, I remind myself that once I was just as alienated from my enemies, from God, as my enemies are from me. I was once as distant from God as my enemies are from me. I was once as much an affront to God as my enemies are an affront to me. And although the fault was all mine, God took the initiative. He reached out to me. God took the burden to make peace on himself. He took the hurt on himself. And when we love our enemies, we testify that we ourselves have been the recipients of great mercy. We are debtors to grace. We testify that Jesus has rescued us and we belong to him now. Jesus said, "This is how all people will know that you're my disciples, if you love." This is how we know what love is, John wrote. Jesus Christ laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives too. Love your enemies, 4 whys and 3 hows. Why should I love my enemies? Number 3, because God will use my obedience to reconcile some of my enemies to himself. In the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus said, "Let your light shine before all men so that they might see your good works and glorify your Father in heaven." Part of those good works is loving our enemies. Paul says, "If your enemy is hungry, feed him. If he's thirsty, give him something to drink. In doing this, you will heap burning coals on his head." You know, there's been a lot of debate for centuries over what that means precisely. But almost everyone agrees that what it means is that your enemy will have a red face because of your kindness. He'll feel ashamed of himself. He'll come under conviction and he'll turn to Jesus. When we read Paul's words here, we have to remember that this is not just theory for Paul. This is all very personal for him. You see, Paul had been himself on both sides of the equation that he lays out in Romans chapter 12. He was once a fierce persecutor of the church. Saul of Tarsus stood by holding the coats of the men who stoned Stephen to death. Saul heard Stephen's prayer of intercession, "Father, forgive them. Don't charge this sin to their account." The fruit of Stephen's intercession was Saul's conversion on the Damascus road. And then Paul the apostle was himself beaten and whipped and falsely accused and wrongly imprisoned. At Lystra, he was stoned and he was left for dead. And after the believers gathered around him and prayed, he got up and he went right back into the city and preached again. See, Paul was once the enemy who was loved by believers. And as a result, he became a believer who was then challenged to love his enemies too. Paul could say from experience, this really does work. God really does use the love of believers for their enemies to reconcile some of them to himself. Love your enemies, 4 whys and 3 hows. Why should I love my enemy? Number 4, because my faith grows in the process. You see, as I love my enemy, my faith in God's mercy grows, and also my faith in his justice grows. Loving my enemies testifies that eternal outcomes mean more to me than temporary earthly outcomes. The writer of Hebrews says, remember the days when you endured great conflict full of suffering. Sometimes you were publicly exposed to insult and persecution. You joyfully accepted the confiscation of your property because you know that you yourselves had a better and lasting possession. So don't throw away your confidence. It will be richly rewarded. For in just a little while, he who is coming will come and will not delay. You see, by refusing to take matters into my own hands and retaliating against my enemy, I defer to God's justice. Pastor Nick shared last week how God uses human authorities to administer his justice here on earth. God has established authority in the home, authority in schools, authority in churches, and God has established the authority of human governments to keep order in society and to punish wrongdoers. He uses nations to keep other nations in check and to punish them, and as believers, we're permitted to take advantage of that and participate in that. But beyond that, when this life is over, every person will stand one by one before Jesus, and God will administer perfect justice. You know, that means that we can keep calm about our enemies. We don't have to wring our hands. We don't have to fret over what they're doing. God sees everything. Hebrews says, and there is nothing hidden from the eyes of the one to whom we all must give an account. Beloved, I want you to look at me for just 1 minute this morning. Don't let the daily headlines cause anxiety in your heart. Don't let them make you angry. God sees everything. God knows every secret of the NSA and the CIA and the FBI. God knows every past and present secret of the White House and the Kremlin and the Pentagon and Capitol Hill and the J. Edgar Hoover building. God knows every hack and every wiretap and every leaker, and he will hold every wrongdoer accountable. And see, knowing that God will take care of justice, it liberates me to love my enemy. The biggest obstacle to forgiving my enemy and loving him is that my sense of justice has been violated. And I can't rest until I see it put right. That's actually a God-given inclination. It's one of the many ways we're made in his image. But when I know that justice is in God's hands, and I know that he won't miss, I can relax and love my enemy. You see, one way or the other, we will always triumph if we love our enemies and refuse to retaliate against them. God might work through our obedience, and they might have coals of fire on their head. They might come under conviction. They might repent and turn to Christ. And in that case, the penalty he paid on the cross will be applied to them, and justice will be satisfied, just like it was applied to us. Otherwise, God will administer perfect justice on the great and final day when we all stand before him. And his justice is perfectly fair. But either way, if we love our enemies, we will not lose. We will triumph in the end. Love your enemies. We shared 4 whys. Now let's share 3 hows. How can I love my enemies? First of all, I love them by praying for them. Echoing the words of Jesus, Paul says, bless those who persecute you, bless and do not curse them. Jesus said, pray for those who mistreat you. So how do we bless our enemies? Well, in this context, Jesus is clear that it's something we do with our mouth. I find that blessing takes 2 forms. First of all, blessing is how we speak about our enemies. Whether it's to ourselves or whether it's to others, Jesus said, bless and do not curse. Beloved, will you look at me for 1 moment? It is time for us as lovers of Jesus to get off the name-calling merry-go-round that that has overtaken our social discourse. I know that our country has faced turbulent times in the past, but I have to say, in my lifetime, I cannot remember another time when there has been so much rancor in the public discourse. And calling your opponent names is not blessing them, it is cursing them. Listen, calling your opponent a bigot is not blessing them. Racist or homophobe or xenophobe or misogynist or fascist. Neither is calling your opponent a snowflake or a millennial if it's used pejoratively or triggered. Jesus said, bless and do not curse. Paul said, love is patient and kind. It doesn't speak boastfully. Listen, it doesn't dishonor others. It always believes the best. It always helps for the best. Love never gives up on people. Let's make sure that we don't participate in today's name-calling game, either in our heads or in our conversations or in what we share on social media. And all God's people said, amen. Oh my. Blessing is how we speak about others, and blessing is speaking to God about our enemies. I'm not sure that we really realize just how powerful our prayers are. Do you know, when God was about to destroy Sodom, Abraham begged God to look again and to see if he could find any occasion to show mercy on that city. And because Abraham asked, God said, all right, Abraham, I'll look again. I'll see if I can find some way to show mercy. After the children of Israel sinned with the golden calf, God told Moses, move out of the way so that I can punish them. And Moses said, no, I refuse. And because he stood in the gap, God was unable to release the punishment. But Moses' prayers changed God's mind. God said, before I bring judgment on any people, on any nation, on any land, I look for an intercessor to stand in the gap, and I'm astonished if I can't find one, for I take no delight in the death of the wicked. Our prayers have the power to change God's mind about people and about situations. Our prayers have the power to change people's destinies. Jesus said, pray for your enemies. Ask God to be merciful to them, just like he was merciful to you. Ask God to call them to salvation, just as he called you. Ask God to give them the very best in this life and eternal life afterward. Don't rejoice when your enemy falls into hardship. Mourn with them and pray that they'll look up to God for comfort. Oh, can I tell you, sometimes the things Christians say after calamities fall on people and they release statements in the airways, well, they got what was coming to them. That's not what the Bible says. The Bible says, mourn with them when they're mourning and pray they'll look to God for comfort. Don't get angry when blessings fall on your enemies. Celebrate with them and pray that God will make their hearts grateful. Rejoice with those who rejoice and weep with those who weep. Ask God to use you to be the one who points them to Christ. When the Jewish leaders threatened the first believers in Jerusalem, they went to prayer. And they said, oh God, look at how they're threatening us. But then they didn't pray, now get up, God. Instead, they prayed, look at how they're threatening us, God. Stretch out your hand to heal and perform signs and wonders through the name of your holy servant, Jesus. In other words, Lord, use us in the supernatural signs that will win them to Jesus. On the cross, Jesus prayed for his enemies. Father, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing. Do you know that it's impossible to pray for someone? If you pray for someone with any kind of regularity, if you pray for them with any kind of consistency, it is impossible to stay angry with that person. It's impossible to pray for someone and not begin to feel God's heart of compassion for that person. As we pray for our enemies, we gain God's insight into the spiritual ignorance that is holding them bound. Jesus said they hated me without reason. The hatred of his enemies and the hatred of our enemies is illogical hatred. It doesn't make sense that they're so agitated by us. It doesn't make sense that they're so angry with us. It's not normal. It's spiritual in nature. It is fueled by an antichrist spirit. And as we pray for them, God will give us insight into what is holding them bound. Father, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing. When they were stoning Stephen, he prayed, Father, forgive them. When Paul was in prison, he prayed for his persecutors that they would surrender to Jesus. Did their prayers work? Well, when you get to heaven, you can ask the dying thief on the cross if Jesus' prayer of intercession worked. You can ask the Roman centurion who stood at the foot of the cross and said, surely this man is the Son of God. You can ask the many priests from Jerusalem who became followers of Jesus in Acts chapter 6 after the church prayed for their enemies in Acts chapter 4. You can ask Paul who watched Stephen die in prayer. And then when he was blinded on the Damascus road, Ananias came to minister to him. And Ananias was shaking in his boots because Saul had killed so many Christians. But he prayed for his enemy and something like scales fell off of his eyes and he could see again. Ask the Philippian prison warden who fell down on his knees before Paul and said, sir, what must I do to be saved? Ask the Praetorian guards whom Paul witnessed to while they were chained to his wrists. Ask the members of Caesar's household in Rome who became believers in Jesus because of Paul's prayers for his enemies from a Roman prison. Their prayers for their enemies worked, and our prayers will work too. You see, this whole heaping coals on your enemy's head thing, it is a supernatural business. This is not pacifism as the world understands it. This is not stoicism. This only works in Christ. This only works through the power of mercy and grace, through the power of the Holy Spirit. As we trust God for the outcomes, God works through our obedience as we bless and we pray for our enemies, and he saves some of them. Love your enemies. Four whys and three hows. How can I love my enemy? Number one, by praying for them. Number two, by pulling back when I want to punch back. Echoing Jesus, Paul says, repay no one evil for evil. Be thoughtful about doing what's right in the sight of all men. As much as possible, as far as it depends on you, live peaceably with all men. Don't avenge yourselves. Peter writes, do not repay, I love this verse, listen to this verse, I love this. Do not repay evil with evil, nor insult with insult. On the contrary, repay evil with blessing, because you were called to bless so that you might inherit a blessing. How can I love my enemies? Sometimes I can love them by just staying quiet and not saying anything. Beloved, there's a lesson that I've had to learn the hard way in life, and I'm still trying to get it down. We don't have to swing at every pitch. We don't have to respond to every shot that is fired across our bow. We don't have to take the bait and get drawn into every argument and every controversy. Sometimes we can just be quiet. You know what? The older I get, the more I've learned being quiet is a beautiful thing. How can I love my enemies? When I need to speak, I speak as thoughtfully and graciously as possible. Paul wrote, let your speech always be full of grace, seasoned with salt, so that you might know how to answer everyone. You know, that doesn't mean that everyone will be satisfied by our diplomacy. Some people are just looking for a fight, and they'll take any opportunity to find offense in your words. You can't do anything about that. That's why Paul says, if possible, as much as it depends on you. How can I love my enemies? By letting it slide when my enemies fail to be diplomatic, or even when they're downright mean. Peter said when they hurled insults at Jesus, he didn't answer them. When he suffered, he made no threats. Instead, he entrusted himself to the one who judges justly. You see, if I retaliate, then my enemy has made me like himself, and he has won. But if I love my enemy, then Jesus has won and good has triumphed over evil. Love your enemies. How can I love my enemy? By praying for them, by pulling back when I want to punch back. And finally, I can love my enemies, I love this, by pursuing those who are pursuing me to show them kindness. Everybody look at me. In Greek, there's a little play on words. We're going to finish with this. In Greek, there's a little play on words in verses 13 and 14 of Romans 12. The very last words of Romans 12, 13 says, practice hospitality. In English, practice hospitality. In Greek, the word is pursue. Pursue hospitality. In other words, look for opportunities to show people hospitality. Don't just wait for an opportunity to present itself. You go looking for an opportunity to bless somebody. You go looking for an opportunity to show them kindness. Pursue hospitality. And then the very next words in verse 14 are bless those who persecute you. That's what it says in English. Do you know what it says in Greek? Bless those who pursue you. So listen, here's the play on words. Pursue hospitality. Bless those who are pursuing you. So in life, there are some people who are pursuing us to agitate us. There are some people who are pursuing us to make us angry. There are some people who are pursuing us to harm us. There are some people who are pursuing us to oppose us. And Paul is saying in these words, those people who are pursuing you for hurt, you pursue to show kindness. Pursue those who are pursuing you to show them kindness. Paul says, if your enemy is hungry, feed him. If he's thirsty, give him something to drink. In doing this, you'll heap burning coals on his head. In other words, you'll make him feel ashamed. Don't be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. Jesus said, bless those who curse you. Pray for those who mistreat you and do good to those who hate you. I have to tell you, for me, it's that last thing that puts this whole loving your enemies thing over the top. It's not hard for me to pray for my enemy. It's really not. That's just between me and God. That happens in the privacy of my own prayer closet. And I can wrestle. I can tell God honestly how I really feel. He knows. And then I can say, you got to help me with this one, Lord, because I really am not liking this person. It's not hard to pray for my enemies. It's not even hard to bite my tongue when I want to retaliate. But it's another thing altogether to look for an opportunity to show my enemy kindness. It's another thing altogether to ask, does my enemy have a need that I can in some way contribute toward? It's another thing altogether to sit at a table with my enemy, especially if it's my table. All right, Jesus, that is where I draw the line. That's more than I can handle. Pursue hospitality. Bless those who are pursuing you. Are you kidding me? But God has a method to his madness. See, it's impossible to pray for someone and stay angry at him. And it's very hard to interact with somebody socially and stay mad at him. When you sit with someone, when you hear their story, you begin to gain a heart of compassion. After working with people for over 30 years, one thing I've learned is that everybody has their story. And when you take time to find it out, when you find out what they've been through in life, the things that they've endured, the things that have happened to them, it's just really hard to stay mad at them. Your heart of compassion begins to grow and you begin to understand why they are the way they are. And isn't that just what Jesus did for us? Although we were God's enemies, Jesus put on a body of human flesh. He left the splendor of heaven and he came to earth and he ate with us. Jesus ate at posh dinner parties. He ate at wedding receptions. He ate at picnics by the beach. Sometimes he just threw something together last minute for 5,000 of his closest friends. But he ate with us. He pursued hospitality for we who pursued him. He blessed us and he prayed for us. Father, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing. Let me finish with an experience that I had over 15 years ago when we were applying for zoning to build this building. We had this property under contract. We had put a deposit, $150,000 deposit, and we invested over $100,000 developing plans for the property, a master plan, plans for these buildings. In order to get zoning approval from the town, you have to show the town what you're going to build. And so we had about over $250,000 invested in the process just to get a zoning approval. And there was a commercial tenant here on this property, a landscaper, who didn't want to lose his place of business. In fact, he had tried to buy this land and he just couldn't get the money together to do it. And so he wrote a horrible letter about our church and he distributed it all over town. Said all kinds of slanderous things. A sect and its followers are trying to build a commune on King Street. Made us sound like the Branch Davidians. That whole thing was going down in the headlines at the time. And as a result, when we came time for our public zoning hearing, a whole mob of angry neighbors showed up to speak in opposition of the church. We had at that time a little praying grandma in our church. I called her, she was 4'11". I called her my little prayer warrior. And she was sitting in the back of the hearing room along with a bunch of our other intercessors just quietly praying. Only she kind of didn't know how to whisper very well. And as one person after the next got up to speak against the church, she was praying in tongues loudly. And my attorney kept looking at me and saying, "What is that?" And I just said, "You don't want to know." But one man in particular got up and he spoke. He was very vocal. And he just spoke really, really forcefully and terribly about our church. He really didn't know anything about us other than what he had read in a letter. And I just remember, I was just livid what he was saying about us. At the end of that hearing, we received unanimous zoning approval to build this building and to build the next building. Thanks be to God. But literally the very next morning, I went into Dunkin' Donuts to get a coffee and I ran face to face with this man. And he didn't know what to say to me, and I didn't know what to say to him. I wanted to say to him, "Repent, you heathen!" But instead, the words that came out of my mouth were, "Hey, I meet you in all the best places." And he laughed. And after that, I would see him, seems like, 3 or 4 mornings a week in Dunkin' Donuts, and I'd always go over to the table and greet him. Nothing long. I would just say, "How you doing?" and go on with my day. One day, it turns out that he was behind me in line, and I paid for his coffee. Something funny happened. Every day after that, he was behind me in line. I think he waited till my car came in and got in line. I bought that guy a lot of coffee. I'm glad it was Dunkin' Donuts and not Starbucks. But I came in one morning and he was seated at the table and I went over to greet him and he said, "Pastor, I'm not doing so well today." He said, "I found out that I have cancer." And I said, "Let me pray for you." And right there in Dunkin' Donuts, I laid hands on him and we prayed together. A little while after that, the Northwest Greenwich Homeowners Association asked if they could use our sanctuary for their annual meeting, and who came in but my buddy from Dunkin' Donuts. And I remember when he came and he stood at the back door and looked into the sanctuary, and it was just a moment, you know, he was just overcome. And he said to me, "Pastor," he said, "this is a beautiful church." And he said, "You are beautiful people." And you know, an enemy became a friend. Because we pursued hospitality for someone who pursued us. When we went for the zoning hearing to approve modifications for phase 2 to up it to 1,000 seats to add the basement underneath, you know, not one person came to speak in opposition of our church. Enemies became friends because of the love of Jesus. You know, I know that some of you have enemies in your life that are far more dangerous than that. I know that they pose a very real threat. I think as a dad, I've come to learn that far more than the people have hurt me, the people that I have the most difficult times are anybody who hurts my children. I can't always promise you this story played out over a period of several years, and I can't promise you that every story will end with a neat little bow on top of it, but I can tell you that you will win every time if you love your enemies like Jesus loved us. Would you stand on your feet and give Jesus a great big praise in this place this morning? Come on, let's give him a good praise this morning.